This episode is brought to you by NordVPN. It's a great way to protect yourself on the web. And they're offering my viewers 77% off a 3-year plan. Just go to nordvpn.com/companyman and use the promo code companyman. It's in the description. We all know about Pillsbury, right? I see them every time I'm at the supermarket. They sell those biscuits in the tube that you have to hit against the counter to get them to pop open. They have pie crusts and other things like that. Here, instead of trying to tell you what I know about them, let me show you their website. They have a ton of recipes on here if that's something you're looking for, but what I'm interested in right now is their products. And the list is exactly what I would have imagined. Biscuits, crescents, cinnamon rolls, cookies, pie crusts, pizza crusts, breakfast, breads, minis, toaster strudels, Pillsbury's best. And then each one of these shows their own list if you click on it, but basically, it's all just refrigerated or frozen dough that you put in the oven and bake. Would that be a good representation of how you know Pillsbury? I mean, is there anything you associate with the company that's much different than any of this? Because if that's the case, I think you're underestimating them, in a way. Now, if you're talking about what Pillsbury looks like today, we've already showed a pretty accurate picture, but in the past, this was a really big company. There's an impressive history here that involves many other brands that today we wouldn't even imagine associating with Pillsbury. The name Pillsbury is the name of a man. It comes from Charles Pillsbury. He's the one who started the whole company, and I found the way he did it to be really motivational. It happened a long time ago. It was 1869. He was 27 years old at the time. What he did was he teamed up with his dad to pool together whatever money they could, which ended up being about $10,000, and they bought 1/3 of a struggling flour milling business in Minneapolis. The business would basically turn wheat into flour. Soon after the purchase, Charles Pillsbury started making big changes and updating the milling equipment. I'm not too knowledgeable about 19th century milling techniques, so I can't say exactly what he did, but I can say that it worked. Within 3 years, the company was called Pillsbury. It was fully owned by Charles, his father, and his uncle. They bought 2 additional mills, and the company was said to be considerably profitable. That's a pretty good 3 years. During the 1880s, the next decade, they bought 6 more mills, one of which was the world's largest. At the end of that decade, they actually sold the company, but Charles continued running it and eventually turned it into the world's largest milling company before he died in 1899. Now, I want to pull a few lessons from Charles Pillsbury because he did something pretty incredible that I think we can learn from. I like to try to identify lessons that not only apply in business, but in everyday life. The first lesson, I'd say, is to do what you can. There's so many opportunities we encounter that have a large barrier to entry, meaning it's hard to get started. We might say, I can't afford to start my own business or go to college or whatever. Charles Pillsbury was in the same position, but he did what he could. He couldn't afford to buy a flour mill, so he found some help from his father and was able to buy 1/3 of a struggling flour milling business. It was far from the ideal situation, but it was the start that he needed. He did what he could. The second lesson is believing in yourself. When he bought that milling business, he knew nothing about the milling business. And from what I've read, the milling business wasn't thought to be the best business, but he ignored what everyone else was saying and his own doubts that I'm sure he must have had. He believed that he'd be able to succeed in the new industry. His confidence helped him learn about everything to a degree where he was able to make some major changes that had a positive impact on the company. Charles Pillsbury is largely responsible for turning a small business into the largest of its kind. So there's obviously other lessons we could learn here, but these two felt the most important to me, and I think they're too often overlooked. I want to jump ahead a little bit. In the 1920s, ownership of the company returned back to the Pillsbury family, and in the 1940s is when their expansion really started. That's when they bought the Global Grain and Milling Company, which further built their flour milling business, but also resulted in the production of pancake and biscuit mixes. Later in the 1940s, they started their line of cake mixes. In the early 50s, they acquired a company called Ballard & Ballard, who made refrigerated goods. All of this helped them grow and enter industries that were a little different from their original focus, but it wasn't until 1967 when they made an acquisition that you wouldn't expect. Are you ready to hear it? Burger King. In 1967, Pillsbury bought Burger King. Now, they weren't anywhere near the size they are today. At the time, it was only a 13-year-old restaurant with 274 locations. Compare that to the 17,000 that they have today. But still unexpected. That was their initial entry into the restaurant business. In the following years, they either started or acquired multiple brands in both the restaurant and consumer foods industries. It's a long list, so I don't want to mention every one of these, but I do want to mention the ones that stand out to me. In 1975, they entered the business of frozen foods by acquiring Totino's. They make the frozen pizzas and the pizza rolls, of course. And 4 years later, they followed up on that with the acquisition of Green Giant. They make the frozen vegetables, but you probably also know them for their mascot, the Jolly Green Giant. In 1983, they bought Häagen-Dazs ice cream. The following year, they bought Vandykamp, who makes the fish sticks and frozen fish. And then, I want to go back a few years and focus back on the restaurants. In 1976, they started Bennigan's. It's a lot like a TGI Fridays, but with an Irish theme. In that same year, they also bought a restaurant chain called Steak and Ale. In 1984, they bought Diversa Foods, which included Godfather's Pizza and a couple other restaurant chains. Clearly, at this point, they had ventured pretty far from the flour sales that used to make up the entire company, and it's also pretty far from the refrigerated dough that we know from them today. And we can consider most of these additions to be successful. During all these acquisitions throughout the 70s and the early 80s, they were doing well financially. In the 14-year period between 1972 and 1986, every year, Pillsbury set records for both sales and earnings. They were doing better every year and beating the competitors. But in the later part of the 1980s, things slowed down, and Pillsbury itself was acquired by another giant in the food industry named Grand Metropolitan, who, without getting into specifics, was able to bring Pillsbury back to good standing. In 1995, Pillsbury acquired a company named Pet Incorporated for $2.6 billion. Through this, they obtained the brands of Old El Paso and Progresso, among other things. In 1997, the company that owned Pillsbury, Grand Metropolitan, merged with Guinness to form a new company called Diageo, who is currently the owner of many liquor brands. That 1997 merger made Grand Metropolitan, now called Diageo, much more focused on the liquor brands, and it made them less interested in ownership of a company like Pillsbury, which leads us to when they sold it in 2001. To a company called General Mills. Now, this was a complicated deal, since both companies had to sell off certain parts of the business to avoid forming a monopoly. As a result of this, Smucker's would make the cake mixes and frostings and everything else you see in that aisle, and as of recently, that's changing. The acquisition price of Pillsbury ended up being $10.5 billion, and it didn't even include everything. Like, Burger King, for instance, remained with Diageo. And, by the way, Burger King, 2 years later, they sold it for $1.5 billion. When Pillsbury bought them back in 1967, the price was $18 million. So that helps illustrate just how much Pillsbury and their owners helped make Burger King into what it is today. The odd thing about this General Mills Pillsbury acquisition is that Pillsbury started in Minneapolis, and General Mills is located in Minneapolis. So they went full circle and ended up right where they started. Well, geographically anyway. And that's how things remain today. Pillsbury is currently part of General Mills. Now, I want to make a note right here. I felt like I sort of left you hanging by not following through on all these brands I mentioned and talk about where and how they currently exist, but this video would be so much longer if I did that. For example, Green Giant was acquired by General Mills as part of the Pillsbury deal, but as of a few years ago, they're somewhere else. This video just touches on too many different topics to properly cover everything in this time period. Each of these brands has a story that merits its own video, so I'll save that for the future, when I have enough time to give it justice. And plus, that wasn't my purpose for making this video anyway. My goal was to simply bring a little more awareness to Pillsbury, how it started and what it once was. The brand that we all know to be associated with dinner rolls and pie crusts used to own Burger King. Let me know in the comments, did you know any of this? And if you were somewhat familiar with the history of Pillsbury, I must have said something that caught you off guard. So, what were you most shocked to hear? I'm sure you can tell by now that, for me, it was the Burger King thing, by far. And also, what did you think of Charles Pillsbury buying part of that small business? Were you able to relate to the lessons I pulled from it, or were you able to gain something else that I didn't even mention? Maybe you didn't see it as being motivational at all. I'd like to hear what you have to say. I want to take this opportunity to tell you more about today's sponsor, NordVPN. I'm happy I have the opportunity to bring some awareness to this because internet security is a much bigger issue than I ever realized. Both people and companies have issues with this on a daily basis. It's a lesson we only seem to learn after something bad happens, and I was fortunate enough to learn it early. It became real for me when I learned about someone else on YouTube named Boogie2988. His YouTube account was hacked, and he had his channel deleted, and I just couldn't imagine if something like that happened to me. Naturally, he now uses NordVPN, and so do I. See, when you're using the internet, all your information is out there, all willy-nilly. People can learn your location and passwords, and it's one of those things you don't even want to think about. NordVPN protects you from all of this using military-grade encryption. I like the sound of that. They use super-fast servers in 62 countries, there's no data logging, and you can use it on 6 different devices at the same time. They even offer a 30-day money-back guarantee that allows you to try it without any risk. I like the sound of that too. And they're offering my viewers a great deal. It's 77% off a 3-year plan. All you have to do is go to nordvpn.com/companyman and use the promo code companyman. It's all in the description, and thank you for watching.